Yes, Chandrasekhar, one request is, can you share this in the presentation mode so that we can see the entire screen?
You want me to
yeah, it's a PowerPoint
screen. Full screen, is it?
Yeah, in the presentation mode by pressing F5.
Full screen.
Yes. The agenda of this 2 hours discussion is already on this slide. These are all pillars of great Azure architecture. We will also try to visit different types of architectures. We will try to get the importance about them, important point, tools which are participating in that architecture. What are the roles of these different tools? That also we discuss. But overall discussion will revolve around these 6 headlines. Because whenever we design any architecture, okay, just making the architecture to function is one point. But in addition to that, in order to design it end-to-end enterprise level, we have to ensure whether these all 6 pillars of the architecture have been designed up to the mark, up to the expectations. So security, performance and scalability, efficiency and operations, shared responsibilities, availability and recoverability, and cost. Now here, only one component is being shown going down, but rest of the components we have to have going up. So we have to have utmost security, we have to have utmost performance and scalability, we have to have utmost shared responsibility. So everything except cost we have to have utmost. Okay, the cost only is such a thing which we have to have least. Now say all these remaining 4 things are inversely proportional to the cost. So here we have to have balance of these 5 things with the cost. We have to ensure the cost is within the within the expectation, with utmost security, performance and scalability, efficiency, shared responsibility and availability and recoverability. Okay, so what are all measures we are supposed to take here? What are all best practices we are supposed to take here in order to achieve best security, performance and scalability, shared responsibility and all those? Okay, that is what the part of the discussion is on today. Now here, in case if it is on-premise infrastructure available, okay, and here is a demand curve. Okay, demand goes up, maybe it is a seasonal product, so demand will go up whenever season comes, or maybe this product is launched with some advertisement discount and that's why demand is going up. But what we have to have is we have to have infrastructure capable of meeting our needs which are at the peak. But in this case, what will happen is that our infrastructure will be fully utilized when your demand is reaching up to the peak. But whenever your demand goes down, at that time, your infrastructure is underutilized. Normally what happens is you hardly will have infrastructure up to this level. You normally used to have infrastructure up to this level, okay, because perhaps you may not sense or you may not realize that there will be a peak. Sometimes your demand goes beyond your expectations. In that case, what happens is that in this period, whenever demand is going beyond the capacity of your infrastructure, at that time, your infrastructure, okay, starts giving you up on some fronts. Okay, maybe it runs short of memory, maybe it runs short of storage, maybe it runs short of compute. And ultimately what happens is your clientele faces that heap, that heat, that your clientele remains short of getting necessary services. So here in that case, what happens is you cannot immediately increase your infrastructure. After all, it's a long administrative process. Your increase of the infrastructure has to go through. Okay, so whenever you request for increase of the infrastructure, lately you may get the infrastructure ready. Thereafter, in case your demand goes up, now your infrastructure is up and ready to deal with that demand. But for some time, your clientele will have to bear with your system, as your system is going under very much stress against the demand. Okay, so that is one of the reasons why we always go for a cloud. So here we have to have something called as a scalability. And on the cloud, you get utmost scalability. The scalability can be managed manually. Scalability can be configured to get managed automatically also. So auto-scalable is something which does not incur human intervention to scale the resources. Okay, and your resource gets automatically scaled as per the demand. When demand is high, resources are pulled in, and whenever demand goes low, resources are relinquished. Your bill is incurred only on the quantum of the resources you are utilizing. Okay, how much RAM you are utilizing, how much storage you are utilizing, and the compute you are utilizing. So here your billing will be higher, and here your billing will be lower. So that is auto scaling. So whenever we think of designing for performance and scalability, the auto scaling is very important. Okay, here we will try to understand what do we mean by scale up and what do we mean by scale out also. So later on some slide that also has been discussed. So a couple of other points regarding performance and scalability. Scaling is the process of allocating scale units to match the performance of the requirement. This can be done either automatically or manually. Now, whenever your resources are being relinquished, whenever there is a demand goes down, in that case, what happens that wastage also goes down. Waste means what? That your demand is low, but your resources are up and running. Those resources are, in case you are underutilized, they keep increasing your bill, but your demand is low. Then we call it as a waste. So scaling talks about a waste. Scaling also talks about increased service level agreement also. Okay, so scale up means what? Adding resources within one machine. So increasing RAM of the machine, increasing storage of the machine, increasing adding more CPUs to the rack. That is a scale up. Okay, now scale up is not a solution to meet the increased demand. It cannot be a solution all the time for meeting increased demand. Yes, it may be solution up to one level, because you can increase the number of CPUs to increase the compute. You can increase RAM and storage devices, okay, to increase the storage capacity. But you cannot increase bus capacity. Bus capacity means address bus capacity and data bus capacity. That cannot be increased. So there is a limit of getting maximum performance from the infrastructure. What you need to do is you need a system where not only you can add compute and storage, you also can add data transfer capacity. I mean to say, increasing size of the data bus, increasing size of the address bus. In the infrastructure, single machine infrastructure, it is not possible. And then there comes a concept called as a scale out. In case of scale out, what happens is that every machine what you add into the cluster not only adds a compute which comes with that machine, not only adds a storage that comes with that machine, RAM which comes with that machine, it also adds data bus and address bus. So here, whenever we, instead of increasing the infrastructural capacity of one machine, if we keep adding machines one by one, thereby we are increasing the size of the cluster. Thereby what we get increased resources along with the bus resources also. So data bus size and address bus size also we get increased here. So nowadays we don't think about scale up. We normally think about scale out. Okay, so and a whole big data processing system is developed upon the concept of scaling out. So scale directions we are mentioning here. Okay, let us have a look at a scale unit. Adding X number of worker and web nodes need adding Y number of queues and Z number of storage accounts. So whenever we try to increase one resource, okay, it may not meet your need. Whenever you try to increase one resource, the dependent resources are also to be increased. So adding machines there, okay, it means we have to have increased network capacity also. Auto scaling, dynamically allocating resources to match performance requirement of SLA. Automatically, in case if we can design a system which can be automatically scalable, which can pull the resources as per the need and which can relinquish the resources, release the resources whenever a demand goes down, okay, there we can prevent our system from any kind of human intervention. And such a system gives us a performance better than a system where human intervention is needed. Okay, so auto scaling is really key of success specifically in area of performance and scalability. Partition is one more way for dividing and ruling. Divide your data across multiple nodes. Divide the data into chunks and ensure that one chunk goes into one node only. And then these multiple nodes process your chunk of data concurrently, parallelly. Okay, so there comes parallel processing. There comes a distributed processing that is called as the data is divided into separate partitions that can be managed and accessed separately. It reduces contention. Okay, multiple machines are there, multiple computes are there. All these machines can, do a processing parallelly. Increase the scalability whenever a demand is whenever we have to complete the processing of a huge data, you can add more nodes. Whenever you have to complete the processing in less time, you have to add more nodes to increase the scalability and optimizes performance. These are some basic concepts of performance and scalability. More on performance and scalability. Just a minute. When optimizing for performance, you will look at network and storage to ensure performance is acceptable. Both can impact the response time of your application and database applications and databases. Caching is one more way of performance. Okay, actually, I'm just giving you an overview of one of the pillars of designing, and it is performance and scalability. The more details of this topic will come ahead. Caching, a mechanism to store frequently used data somewhere near to the client. With that, what will happen is whenever client query for the data, that query request need not have to travel along because the response of that query is existing in the nearby cache somewhere. So from there only the response is picked up. So web pages may be, images may be, and there may be data chunks, okay, for which give faster retrieval of the data. We need to monitor the performance of your application, different parts of the application, different services, those are playing the role in overall execution of the application. So we have to have monitoring tools also. Okay, so user utilization of the system, monitoring health of the system, monitoring resource utilization, and identifying the performance bottlenecks. In order to do the performance monitoring, we have different tools available. So those tools also must be up and running, okay, and continuous monitoring or automatically raising the alerts, automated system which can raise the alert when it realizes that some specific resource is being overutilized. Okay, so their monitoring tools are useful. Availability and recoverability. Now, availability and recoverability, these two are different terms. Approaches to deal with them are different. tools to deal with them are different. So what do you mean by availability? So availability means making your application available, making your storages available, making your computes available, making your services available all the time. That is called as availability. For some reason, in case if one instance goes down, okay, ensuring that another instance is up and running and there must not be interruption in the services even for a while, that is called as availability. So designing for availability focuses on maintaining uptime through small-scale incidences and temporary conditions like partial network outage. So in case if one route goes down, services will be provided through another route. In case if one instance goes down, services will be provided through another instance. In case if some service is not available for a while, okay, there will be alternative arrangement for that service, which will ensure that services will be provided without interruption. So that is all about availability. So here what is essential is just to read this particular statement. We have to find out the points of failures in your complete infrastructure. Okay, and you have to ensure that for these points of failure, you have alternative arrangements. So identifying the single point failures and providing the alternative arrangement for that is necessary. Redundancy of the components with clustering and load balancing. Okay, so what exactly mean by clustering, everybody knows, and load balancing also, I need not have to explain. Okay, but load balancer specifically is one of the point of failure. If load balancer itself goes down, then how your request will reach to the nodes in the cluster? In case if one of the node in the cluster goes down, there are alternative clusters which will take up the workload and provide you the responses. But what about the load balancer? So you have to have alternative arrangement for load balancer also. As far as recoverability is concerned, recovery from large case disasters. Large scale disaster means it means your data center if goes down, then who will provide the services to the clients? Whether clients will face some kind of outbreak within the services? How much outbreak is tolerable? How much data loss is tolerable? And what are all solutions on this? So geo replication is one of the examples. So when your data, when your computes are replicated geographically, so even if once a data center goes down, okay, clientele request will be, you know, routed towards another. Hello. Yes. So design for recoverability focuses on recovery from the data loss and from large scale disasters. So geo replication is one of the solutions here. Okay, what are all other solutions that we will discuss as we will move ahead? That availability and recoverability, efficiency and operations. Nothing to be said that more the intervention of the human, okay, less is the efficiency and more is the stress on operations. Because whenever we rely on human to do the things, okay, there are, you know, cost because of human errors. There are cost because of slow working, okay, not taking timely action. So all are human errors. So here the prime or key of success for efficiency and operation is auto scaling and auto managing the activities. Inefficiency and waste of spending money has to be identified through the proper and timely monitoring. So storage is provisioned for higher data warehouse unit, okay, or request unit. Virtual machine is idle for longer time. Oh, okay. So here, whenever we are talking about auto scaling, what is the benefit of auto scaling is not only it can, you know, manage resources, pool in resources or release resources as per the demand. Okay, it keeps your billing minimal. That is also one of the benefits. So paying for licenses, even if owns, in case if you already have a license on for a product on premise, and whenever you are migrating that product on the cloud, then you don't have to pay a license for that. Okay, ideally your license get migrated there. Okay, so sometimes we end up paying for the services for whom we already have a license for on-premise. Storing infrequently accessed data, costly storages, and many more. Okay, so there are a couple of points we need to take care whenever we try to address for efficiency and operations. More on efficiency and operations. I will make it a full screen, just a minute. Yes. I directly jump to slide number 9. Okay. Importance of efficiency and operations. Just highlighted points would like to bring to the notice. Cloud is a pay as you go service. Waste typically comes from provisioning more capacity than demand requires, so you have to ensure waste will be minimum. Apply all best practices for efficiency. So as we will understand efficiency and operations in further detail, there we will revisit these points again. Okay, operational best practices. So automate as much as possible. Human elements are always costly. One more point would like to bring to your notice. The PaaS services typically cost less than IaaS services. This point is important because PaaS services are fully managed services. So you don't have to bother about managing them. Okay, so automatically they are scaled. And they are quickly scaled. So in case if you can prefer PaaS over IaaS. Okay, that is another best service. Best practice. Okay, fine. You can use automation to build, deploy, and administrate resources. Common activities you have to automate. Yes. So automation is the key of success here. Now, let us talk about shared responsibility. Now, for shared responsibility, among whom we are sharing the responsibilities of managing the infrastructure. One is you, who will be managing, because you are using all, you are designing the application and you are providing an application which is up and running. Okay. Another is your cloud. Who is providing you infrastructure? You are managing the application and somebody is providing you infrastructure for the application. And the third is client. Anyway, you don't expect from client to manage all these things. So the sharing of the responsibility is between you and the cloud. Whenever you talk about services on premise, everything you have to manage. All the things you have to manage. But whenever you decide to use machines, virtual machines on IaaS, in that case, virtualization, servers, storages, and networking, these four things are what all provided by your cloud. On getting these things, you will choose the node with a specific kind of operating system. You will have to configure the operating system. So configuration, management of middleware, runtime, applications, and data, everything you are responsible. So whenever you, it's a responsibility on you. Okay, here then, your agility comes into importance. More agile you are in working, okay, better your infrastructure function. Okay, so in case if you choose for PaaS service, in PaaS service, what happens is all the things are managed by cloud. I already have made a statement that PaaS services are less costly. I mean to say, are economic. So they manage more things till they are more economic. So it is double winning situation like. Okay, so they are cost effective as well as they are provide better automation. What you have to do is you have to avail the service and manage it. Avail the service only. Okay, so very less responsibility is with you in that case. In case of SaaS, what happens is, okay, everything is managed by cloud. Whenever demand grows, scaling. Whenever demand goes down, scaling. Everything is managed by cloud. So SaaS services are, you know, completely managed by cloud. But in case if you want to develop and say deploy customized application, then you can go with PaaS services. So these are all operational best practices wherein in case if your responsibility is shared much more by the cloud, okay, load on you will be less and cloud can manage all these things with better efficiency than you. So shared responsibility is again a key of success. Security. There are multiple layers with which the securities are designed. So here you observe physical security, door drafting, applying different kinds of locks. Okay, so that is a physical security. Identity and access is the next level of security. Security cannot be maintained and managed by one tool, and security cannot be handled by one layer also. Okay, in case if there are multiple securities, multiple layers ensure you stringent security. So identity and access, exposing credentials and unlimited permissions, here OpenID, OAuth, Kerberos come into picture. So your password security is a kind of identity and access. Perimeter security is a denial of services. There are sometimes of virus, subtypes of viruses which you know block the resources, leaving you to work within limited resources. Okay, and that is called as a denial of services. So they keep blocking the resources. Okay, network security in case if there is some, you know, port remained open by mistake, then there are chances that somebody may peep into your application through that port and there may be some kind of brute force attacks they will do. So those are not nothing but network securities. Different malwares, viruses, they are breaching compute security. SQL injections and cross-site scripting, their application level security. And whenever you store data to the storage device, okay, if you can properly encrypt the data, and while reading, in case if you can decrypt the data, then that is called the data security. So security also can be managed, has to be managed at different levels, different arrangement, different tools, different services are available for these purposes also. So data is sensitive. The level of the sensitivity of the data may change data to data. Okay, there are different legal and regulatory requirements also. Okay, so border restriction on the data for some companies, data cannot go outside India. Okay, general data protection regulation. Okay, payment card industry, health insurance. So different types of data security are to be considered. Okay, and considering the severity of the data, we have to apply different level of the security. In the meantime, let me, in case if you have any question, keep posting your questions in the chat box. So let me keep checking with the chat box. Yes. Okay. So whenever we conduct a 201 session, all these aspects are covered in further detail. That is what the aim of the 201 session. Okay. Let me move to the next deck of slides. We cover all these things and rigorous hands-on on all these aspects. Okay, let me take you to the another deck of slides now. Just a minute. Big data use cases. As on today, it is a world of analytics. There is not even a single field left where we cannot apply analytics. Everywhere we can apply analytics. It is essential for us. How can we harness the power of analytics in that specific domain? Okay, and still this field is getting evolved. So I mean to say that even giant companies are also, you know, starving for how they can more effectively use the data which is with them. Hello, anybody has anything to say? Somebody, I think, has unmute himself. Just let me know whether you can keep yourself on mute, please. Huh?
I have one question.
Yeah. Is it possible in case if you can put your question in the chat box?
Yes.
I will answer it. I will read for all of you and I will answer it.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, please. Let me check whether I have received any question. Not yet. Okay. Okay, in the meantime, I received a question. Let me discuss some three architectures here. We call it the modern data architecture. Here we are discussing batch processing architectures, different batch processing designs and architectures. Modern data warehouse, advanced analytics, and real-time analytics. Now here one more thing is to be understood. Okay, in these architectures, what are all different tools we will be using, different tools and services, and why those tools and why those services, what are all alternative tools or services available? That also we will try to see here. In the meantime, I have got one question. No question. Okay. I'm waiting for the question.
I think I don't have access to the chat.
No, how come you will not have access? I think everybody has access to chat.
It is showing administrator has disabled chat for one or more users.
Okay, let me check with the Manish in the break and I will come back. Okay. But in the meantime, would like to know whether my screen is still visible.
Yes, visible.
Yes. So here we will try to understand different services and tools, and we will have a glimpse of some of the designs here. So modern data warehouse, advanced analytics, and real-time analytics. So modern data warehouse. Up till now, we used to create a design keeping our on-premise limitations in mind. So up till now, we used to design an application on-premise, based on on-premise business intelligent solutions. We used to use MS SQL database, integration service, analysis service, and reporting services. All these services are installed on-premise. Not enough scalable, not able to cope up with the growing business needs. All these are the limitations we are already facing on-premise. Okay, maintenance of the services, scaling of the services, everything we are, you know, liable for. Cannot deal with unstructured data, including JSON data. Okay, up till now, we did not realize the importance of, you know, unstructured data. And that may be the reason that we might not have added, you know, all the features here for the public. In modern data warehouse, I will show the design of the modern data warehouse. Here it is. And I will explain you all the services also. So some of us perhaps are aware of all these services, but maybe some of us are not aware. I am quickly covering for them. There are different data sources from where data is being pulled in. So there is something called as a data factory. Data factory can be used to create a data pipeline. So data pipeline means data factory has many connectors to connect to different data sources. Now, what are all data sources data factory can connect to? It can connect to logs of the servers. From there, it can pull the data. It can connect to different media storages like Azure storage account, like Azure data lake store. It can connect to flat files. It can connect to other applications from where it can procure the data. So variety of the data sources it can connect to. In case if you can have a peep into data factory, you will see you can connect to SAP environment. You can connect to even AWS environment also. You can connect to multiple data sources at the same time and can pull the data from there. Data, whenever you are receiving from the variety of the data sources, obviously, the data formats are different, data structures are different. So here we have to, you know, somehow apply some kind of transformations before you can stage that data into some staging environment. Here the staging environment can be data lake storage. Before your data goes into data lake storage, you can think of applying some kind of transformation. So those transformations are really available in data factory. In data factory, you can apply some transformation and you can convert data into a specific data format, and then you can move that data to the data lake storage. So data lake storage is a staging environment. Data can be given to the data factory for analytical processing, or it can be moved to SQL data warehouse for querying purpose. What is difference in between data lake store, SQL data warehouse, and data factory? Not data factory, sorry, data bricks. Data bricks is storage plus compute. It has its compute also. So in case if you want to apply some kind of transformations which are not perhaps possible in data factory, then you can add that transformation or you can do that transformation here in data bricks. Your textual data, which you cannot upload into SQL data warehouse, because SQL data warehouse can support only data which is a schema based, which has a schema. Only that data can go to SQL data warehouse. But your schema less data, if you want to move and you want to apply some transformation, then you have Databricks to do that. So Databricks store the data, and on Databricks we can apply the transformation also. The transformed data, the data which is converted into schema based data after applying the transformation, can be moved to data warehouse also. Data warehouse can hold only SQL can hold schema based data, because data warehouse basically is for querying purpose. So you can query the data, you can draw different visuals of the data coming from Databricks, of the data coming from data warehouse, and different visuals can be drawn here. So here, in case if you have a brief comparison, okay, here it is written. Data factory is not for storage of data. Data factory is not for compute of the data. It can say simple transformations are possible there, but basically it does not provide you extensive compute. Basically, data factory is for creating data pipeline. Heavy storage is available in data lake storage. Heavy compute is available there in Azure Databricks. There are analytical computations available in Azure Data Warehouse also. But Azure Data Warehouse has a serious limitation of it can handle the schema-based data only. Okay, so data lake store, enormous capacity of the data you can store here. Okay, Azure Databricks, in case if you want to apply some transformation, in case if you want to apply some predictive analytics, that is also possible in Databricks. Azure Analysis Services, here it is. They provide caching capabilities for Azure SQL Data Warehouse. So here a data can be cached. Such a diagram is shown in the examination. And what they will do is, they may keep this area blank and they may ask you to choose a suitable tool for this. They may keep this area blank to ask you to choose a suitable tool for this area. Okay, so you will be given options to choose from, okay, MCQs like questions, and you have to choose appropriate tool from there. They may make this area blank and you may be asked to suggest most suitable tool out of given list of tools. This is advanced analytics. Okay, I come back here and I will show you the limitation of this particular design. Then I will move to advanced analytics. Here what is happening is, data is being provided for the visualization purpose or for the querying purpose. Okay, now how far this data can go? In case if this system is here in India and your clientele in US wants to access your system, then clientele in US will definitely face latency because its request will have to travel long to reach to India and then his query will reach to the data warehouse. Okay, so he may face a latency issues. So for that purpose, then what we can do is, instead of holding that queryable data here on premise or within one data center, we have to have that queryable data, okay, across multiple data centers. Data should be in those multiple data centers from where client can access directly. And there then, there comes a role for Cosmos DB. So same earlier diagram with only one difference, that now there is a Cosmos DB. Cosmos DB is the distributed storage. Distributed storage in the sense that it not only will hold one copy of the data here in India, it also can hold another copy, maybe in somewhere in US continent, somewhere in Europe continent, somewhere in Southeast Asia. Clientele in Southeast Asia will query the data which is in Cosmos DB copy, which is in Southeast Asia. Clientele from US will connect to the Cosmos DB copy, which is in US continent. So there they will face less issues of latency and they keep getting responses faster. So in earlier design and in this design, you will see one difference, and it is of Cosmos DB. So Cosmos DB will have distributed storage. I will move to the third diagram. But here now it is the time for us to take one break. But I think, let me complete the third diagram. Let me complete the third diagram and then we will take a break. In this third diagram, this is basically for real-time analytics. And here you will see there are two pipelines. This is one pipeline and this is another pipeline. In case if Priyanka is hearing me, I will request Priyanka, just give me 3-4 more minutes. Okay, I will complete this diagram and then I will take a 5 minutes break. Yes,
sure, sir.
Okay, now here you observe there are two pipelines. One is a pipeline in which data is coming from IoT devices. Okay, and another is a pipeline wherein data is coming as a batch data. I mean to say, This is the pipeline where data is being processed with a batch processing. And here is the pipeline wherein data is being processed as a stream processing. What is the batch process? What is the stream processing and what is the batch processing? I will discuss in further detail. Okay. Now, batch processing means you procure the data from the file. In one go, you get whole data. And on that data, then you complete the processing. In batch processing, you have to have huge storage devices because you have to have whole data being held at one place. And then in batches, you will process that data. So in batch processing, you have to have whole data at one place before you begin the processing. On the other hand, in stream processing, data comes in smaller batches. This is the sensor device which may be sending you data this sensor device has collected for past 10 minutes. Whatever be the data it has collected since past 10 minutes, it will submit that data and you will apply analytics processing on the data which it has accumulated since 10 minutes. Now here what happens, the data size is limited. You may not get data in petabytes. Okay, so data size is limited, but what is challenging is processing that data, processing one small batch of data before another small batch reaches there. So processing power is very high specifically in stream analytics. So in one application, this is very common scenario that we have to do stream analytics as well as we have to do batch processing. In such scenarios, okay, we have to have two different pipelines. One pipeline wherein data comes with a specific interval of time, or data comes when one batch of data gets completely filled. Okay, so speed of the data, velocity of the data is very high in this case. On the other hand, this pipeline where speed of the data does not matter because ultimately we gather the data at one place only. This pipeline is called as a cold pipeline. Okay, we also call it as a batch pipeline. And this pipeline wherein data is to be processed in time-bound situation, this is called as a hot pipeline. In hot pipeline, your data size may not be too big, but your compute size must be larger enough. So here also you will observe, we have to have some staging environment because the speed with which the data is coming cannot be submitted to the processing unit as it is. Processing may take longer time. So speed of the incoming data is high, but speed of the data consumption, okay, may be low. So in that case, then what we need to do is we have to have somebody who can synchronize these two different ends. These ends are different with respect to the velocity of the data. One end is creating data with a higher velocity and another end is not capable of consuming the data with which it is receiving the data, with the speed with which it is receiving the data. Then we have to have some staging environment in between. This is called as a message broking system. What is the significance of message broking system is that this message broking system has a huge storage capacity. It has a huge storage capacity. That is one thing. And the second thing is it can store the data and it can hold the data as long as you need. Okay. With whatever be the speed of the incoming data. Whatever be the speed of the incoming data. So this is not just a thing which can hold the data. This is a thing which can hold the data despite of which high velocity data is being fed to it. So this is real-time analytics. Here I have to use Kafka. Now Kafka is open source. Yes, it is available on Azure, but besides that, there is something called as the Event Hub. There is something called as the IoT Hub. So Event Hub, IoT Hub, Kafka, all these are the different solutions for merely same thing. Okay, yes. So rest of the diagram is as it is. I think it is a time for us to take a break. I am handing over baton to Priyanka. She wants to talk to you for a while. Okay, in the meantime, let me check whether I have some message. No message. In case if you have any query, you please put it in chat box. And over to Priyanka now. I am putting myself onto mute.
Thank you, Sibi sir. Sibi sir, Amani sir wants to share his screen. So can you just stop sharing yours? So thank you. Hello everyone. Again, this is Priyanka. And I would like to tell you about our company's certification, which certifications we are providing. So we are basically Microsoft Gold Partner. And I would like to tell you about the Azure certifications, Master with Microsoft Azure Certification Virtual Training. So these are the four important reasons why you need to complete your certification. So basically, certifications bridge the gap between knowledge and skills. Certification courses do not take a long period of time. Certification exhibit credibility and commitment, and you become a specialized one. So these are some important reasons. And now you are all at your home. So you we have already done one webinar on how to take how to attend a Microsoft certification exam just by sitting your home. So you can visit our YouTube channel. There you will get this webinar, and it will help you to tell about how you can take the exam just by sitting at home. So this is our initiative during this COVID-19. Situation. We are providing instructor-led trainings. These are the online virtual training. So you just need to enroll for this training. And the trainings are available regarding all the Microsoft Azure certification. So for the virtual training calendar, you just need to visit our company's website. And here we are giving the discount on live training plus MOC plus exam voucher. All of this you are getting only in 17,500. So these are the certification, and this is the calendar you can see on your screen. So just visit our website, or you can just ping me with your details and which certification you are interested in. And I'll just give you the details for these certifications. So next slide, please. So these are the other trainings, and this is the special discount offer, which is valid till only 20th of May. So you will get the training, MOC and exam voucher. I will repeat, you will get it on in only 17,500. Sir, next slide. So here you can see by just sitting at home, you can upgrade yourself by attending this and completing this Azure certifications. For more details, you can contact me, as well as we have shared our concerned person's details on your screen. She is Shilpa Avar, and she is going to take care of all these trainings. So you can directly contact her. We have shared her mobile number and her email ID. Also, if you have any doubt, you want any details, you can also mail me. I have already shared my mail ID. So, thank you. I would like to tell you one more time. After this webinar, we are going to share a feedback form and survey form with you. You will receive this form by today evening or Monday morning. Once the form you have filled, we will share the participation certificate with you guys. And if you want to enroll or register for our other webinars, just visit our website or social channels, and you can register for this event. And one more thing about the Python workshop. We are having two whole day workshop on Python. So we are going to tech 10 participants from the same companies. So if we got registration, if we get the registration, more than 20 registration from one company, then we will took the only 10 participants from that company for one webinar, for one workshop, and other 10 for the other workshop. So if we received many registrations, so maybe you cannot get the chance to attend this workshop. So if possible, register as possible as soon. Thank you.
Channel, please.
Sorry?
The name of your YouTube channel, can you share it?
Yes, I have already shared in the message box. I will share once again. You can search for Synergetics Learning and Consulting on YouTube. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. CB sir, you can continue with the webinar now.
Hello, am I audible there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this diagram I discussed before the break, and here in this diagram I tried to bring two pipelines, data pipelines, to your notice. One pipeline with wherein velocity of the data is really high, and another pipeline has a static data stored in the staging environment, and then okay, at a suitable time we can do the processing of the data. And these are the different tools which we can use here at the different steps in the complete pipeline. Any question on whatever I have covered up till now, let me know please. And thereafter then we will go for rest of the designs. So go ahead with your questions. Okay, so it seems there is a request for recordings. I will convey this message to Priyanka. Okay, as well as YouTube link also. So I will convey that message to Priyanka. Okay, coming back, there is a question. What are the different types of data lake stores, Gen 1 and Gen 2? Yes, there are two types of data lake stores. Let me do one thing. Just a minute. Let me draw one diagram. There are two types of data lake stores. One is a data lake store Gen 1. Data lake store Gen 1. And another is a data lake store Gen 2. Now in data lake store Gen 1, okay. There was a limitation with the read and write speed. There was a limitation with yes, it provides me hierarchical file structure. Okay, and then there were limitations of availability also. Limitation of availability in the sense we did not have, having its snapshot across the geo locations also. Okay, we used to have its copy within the data center only, but there were availability issues with it. Okay, on the other hand, they introduced something called a data lake store Gen 2. Data lake store Gen 2. Okay, Gen 1 was a separate service, but Gen 2 is, again, it is a hierarchical file structure, but it is not a separate service. You get an option to create Gen 2 through Azure storage account. Okay. Create through Azure storage account. What they have done is data lake store features and Azure storage account features. They are clubbed together. So availability of the data Azure storage account is now given to data lake store also. Although data lake store retain its very high read and write speed, or you know, inherit its very high read and write speed from Gen 1. So it is already with high availability. It also comes with high read and write speed. So there are a couple of differences between them. If you compare on the ground of the cost, you will realize Gen 2 is less costly compared to Gen 1. So it is cost effective also. Cost effective also. So there are some benefits of Gen 2. API is kept same. There is no change in API. So whatever API you use for Gen 1, same API you can use for Gen 2. Whatever different tools you might have used to access Gen 1, same set of tools you can use in Gen 2. Okay, but these are a couple of benefits. Is there a question? Have I answered this question properly? Swanan? Hello? Hello. Anything else do you expect to swan in this discussion? Let me know, please. I am going back to the design. Sorry.
You have answered, so whatever I needed. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Let us talk about the Lambda architecture. Lambda architecture is a similar kind of architecture what we have seen here. The real-time analytics on big data. Okay, in open source domain, we call it the Lambda architecture. In every application, we normally see two data pipelines. One is a stream analytics and another is a batch processing. Lambda architecture talks about having different data pipelines for these two processing, different set of tools. Okay, so here you observe, this is a batch layer processing and this is a speed layer processing. What batch layer will do, it will do processing and will hold the data in the serving layer from where it can be queried. In speed layer also, what it will do, it will hold the data and maybe showing the data on different kinds of visuals. So it may hold the data which can be to the data storage which can query also. It can present the data for different kinds of visuals. So here also in Lambda architecture, we can see there are two different pipelines. Just to cite one example where I have to have Lambda architecture, okay, is in case if in city there are a number of CCTVs fixed to track the traffic on every road, every route. Okay, and what that CCTV camera is doing is, it is capturing each and every vehicle which is passing through that route. Okay, and from this capture, what we are expected to do, we have to create the answers for the questions like how many vehicles are running on the in the city on a specific day, how many vehicles passed through for whole last month. Okay, in addition to that, how many vehicles of specific make are running on the road in the city? Hello, will you please keep yourself on mute? Please keep yourself on mute. Yes. So we want to know how many vehicles of a specific make were running on the in the city last week or last month or last year. In addition to that, I also want to know, is there any vehicle running in the city which has been registered as a stolen? Is there any vehicle police is searching for against whom there is any criminal complaint is registered? So now, in order to answer these two questions, how these two questions need two different ecosystems, let us understand. How many vehicles there were on the road last month, okay, is a kind of a batch processing. What we will do is batch processing. What we will do is we will gather the data of the last month and then we will apply some compute to answer the question. How many vehicles of a specific make were running last month in the city? For that purpose, we will have to use cognitive analysis. Cognitive analysis means capturing the vehicle is not sufficient. Capturing the vehicle and knowing from the image of the vehicle, what is the make of that vehicle? Okay, so that is again goes into the area of the cognitive analysis. In case if I want to answer the question like whether there is some vehicle running on the road which has been stolen or against whom there is some police complaint registered, okay, in that case, then what we will have to do is we have to have a system which can capture the nameplate quickly. And from the number of the vehicle, we have to do a quick search in the database which has a list of all stolen vehicles or list of all those vehicles for whom police is searching for. Okay, in that list, we'll have to do a quick search. And in case if we want to do this system to be real time, immediately when we realize, when our system realizes that there is one stolen vehicle on the streets, we have to inform to the patrolling van of police about the location of that vehicle and to help police to track that vehicle. Okay, now this kind of system is a real-time system. This system has to raise the alert so immediately that police patrolling van of police which is nearby to that vehicle should be in position to reach there and grab that vehicle as soon as possible. Okay, so having the answers of the last month, last week, that is a bad batch processing. But in case if I want to create a system which can, you know, quickly generate the alert, that is a speed layer. Okay, so here again, the speed layer, in case if I take you to the earlier diagram, in the speed layer, I already brought to your notice Apache Kafka. Okay, and I told you the alternatives to Apache Kafka are Azure Event Hub and Azure IoT Hub. Okay, so such type of systems, Kafka, Event Hub, IoT Hub, we will have to use here. And we have to have some system which can quickly process the images, which can quickly process that the data that it will receive. So we have to have real-time processing systems here. So there may be something called as Apache Storm. There can be something called as Apache Stream Analytics of Spark. Okay, there is something called the Stream Analytics in Azure also. So those services we will have to use here. Okay, and here what we will have to use is a batch processing. Here, complete batch processing. That is called as a Lambda architecture. Okay, so here again, ecosystem changes in the Lambda architecture. This is another design of enterprise business intelligence architecture. On-premise, we can pull the data from on-premise. Then we have to use a storage blob as a ingestion or a staging environment. Then we have to use Polybase-like arrangements to push the data and partition the data into a SQL data warehouse. Then we have to apply some analytics over here. Then for caching mechanism, we will have to use analysis service. And then to push the data to visualize in the Power BI, we may have to have authentication system here. So just quickly go through these three statements. SQL database to SQL data warehouse is good for small size of data, for used data, as your storage blob is always recommended. For a distributed storage, Cosmos DB can be thought of. For OLTP, you have SQL database. For OLAP, you have SQL data warehouse. So that is the differentiator between database and data warehouse. Okay, so some major differentiators are appearing there. Taking you to the next slide now. Just a minute. This slide will take me to the detail. Let me take you to this slide. Now here on this slide, you will observe what are all different alternatives available to do the batch processing. So here you observe Databricks, HD Insight, Data Warehouse, Cosmos DB, Data Lake Store, Storage Gen 2. These are storages which we can use for batch processing also. For serving layer, what are all different alternatives? So Power BI, Spark SQL for querying purpose. Okay, or Azure Databricks also for querying purpose. Okay, analytical services for querying purpose or for caching purpose. For authentication, Azure Active Directory. Okay, and there may be other tools we are using to transfer and upload the data from on-premise to SQL database. So other services are also available. So convert SQL Server data to flat file. Okay, so other tools are also available. Real life challenges. Okay, this is the same design. Just have a quick look. Couple of more services are shown here in this diagram. So data role for the data factory, external data, which may be existing on AWS. Okay, and we can use data factory to pull the data from AWS and hold it into the staging environment of the Azure, which is nothing but a storage blob. Okay, so on-premise data, data from other services, non-Azure services, okay, we can pull in and hold into. Yes. Another design is about conversational bot. Okay, this is basically a dashboard for client customer to do every kind of interaction through one gateway. That is nothing but a conversational bot. So here is the diagram. Just observe, I am showing it in a full screen. Here is the diagram. Here you observe request come from the user. Okay, and before, so he will be using bot logic and UX. Okay, to create the dashboard. This is a kind of a dashboard through which he will interact with the system. Every of his action will be captured in the logging environment. Okay, and whatever his action which needs the responses, so queries will be generated. Okay, so he may be submitting queries, he may be submitting some images, he may be submitting some audios. And then bot cognition or intelligence will do processing of the images, processing of the audios. For that, it may need some historical data. For that, it may need some pre-processed data or data to be processed in real time. So that data will come from here. Okay, and after doing a processing of that data, then responses will be sent to the user. So here what you will see mainly is about bot logic and UX. This is a dashboard through which okay, customer or user will interact with the system. Then we have to have monitoring and reporting system also. Okay, which will keep monitoring the logs, which will keep monitoring different services. Okay, and accordingly, in case if that system realizes that there are some services being overutilized or being underutilized, then necessary emails and alerts to be generated here. So this is conversational bot. Okay, and this is one bird's eye view of conversational bot. Here is the security, which can be managed through identity and access control and key vault. Whenever data goes on the storage devices, it can be Azure storage, it can be Data Lake Store, it can be Cosmos DB. Whenever data goes on the storage devices, it is always encrypted. And a key, now this is a private and public key encryption. Okay, those keys are maintained without in key vault. It can be asymmetric key, it can be symmetric key. Keys are held within key vault. Okay, and your identity information goes into Azure AD. Now for Azure AD, if it is a federal security, Azure AD can interact with your federal security also. It is capable of interacting with the federal security also. So all kinds of securities come here from here. All kinds of dashboard and interaction of the customer comes from here. All kinds of logging comes from here. Then monitoring and reporting. And here is your whole processing system. So that is one of the typical enterprise conversational bot. Yes. Okay. So that is all about batch processing. It is time for me to go to stream processing now. But before I move ahead, would like to ask everybody any question on whatever I have covered. Question, please. Okay. IoT reference architecture, we already have seen a Lambda architecture. Any question, please? No. Okay. We have already seen the Lambda architecture. In Lambda architecture, we already have understood that how high velocity data comes. Okay, how it reaches to the speed layer and how then it is processed. Okay, so let me add a couple of more things there. So here are different tools and services which we will be using for stream analytics. So Azure has its own service, stream analytics. Besides that, Azure provides you support for open source technologies and freeware technologies also. So on HD Insight, Spark, Storm, Kafka instances are available. On Azure Databricks, Spark Stream Analytics with Kafka is available. Besides that, Azure has its own service. We call it the Stream Analytics, through which also analysis can be done. For serving layer, analysis services are there, Power BI is there, Spark Python, visualization library like Matplotlib, Bokeh or ggplot, these libraries are also available. Okay, for ingestion and storages, where we saw the role of the Kafka, okay, their Event Hub, Azure IoT Hub, Apache Kafka instance, they are available. For data at rest, we have blob storages, Azure Data Lake Store. So for staging, for holding the data at rest, storages and data lake store are there. For data which is on the stream, we have to get that data from Event Hub and IoT Hub. Okay, serving layer with Cosmos DB, we can move the data to the Cosmos DB. And interestingly, Cosmos DB is extremely powerful, not only with respect to distributing the data across multiple data centers, across geolocations. There is one more very nice thing about Cosmos DB. Two very nice things about Cosmos DB. One is the consistency of the data. Consistency of the data means whenever any change happens or any update happens within the Cosmos DB instance in India, it ensures that those changes to happen in all other instances. Maybe there is an instance in US, there is an instance in Europe. Okay, changes will be made there immediately. So all the customer base will keep getting consistent data all the time. Besides that, there is another nice thing about the Cosmos DB, and it is it has different interfaces. So Cassandra interface is there, which represents columnar data storage. There are document data interfaces, document storages like MongoDB. Okay, graph storages are also there. So different kinds of interfaces are there, and one Cosmos DB service. Okay, one Cosmos DB service can give you different kinds of interfaces. Okay, whenever you create the instance of the service, at that time, in case if you are creating it for Cassandra, then all over the life of that instance, it will give you Cassandra interface. But in case if you want to hold your data, graph data, then you can create the instance of the Gremlin type there. And there is an interface available to access Cosmos DB through Gremlin also. Different monitoring services are available. So Azure Monitor, collect performance metrics to help monitor the application. So these are different services available here in order to design the application. Let us have a quick look to some of the stream analytics designs. So here you observe, whenever you receive the data from different IoT devices, ideally that data first of all have to go to event hubs. So here are event hubs. Event hubs are what we can say synchronization mechanism to match the speed of incoming data with the speed of consumption. Okay, consumption speed may not be as high as speed of the incoming data. So we need event hub in between. Event hub used to have huge storage capacity. Event hub used to have huge read-write speed. Okay, and that's the reason they can, hold the data with whatever speed the data is coming in. Stream analytics engines will process the data. There will be monitoring system. Processed data can be pushed into Cosmos DB for querying purpose. And clientele from the different parts of this world can, visualize that data. Same processing system, okay, but here I am using Databricks. Again, we are pulling the data from event hubs, but instead of processing the data into stream analytics, we will use Databricks. Databricks has a Spark engine inside, working inside it. And the benefit of a Spark engine is it provides me variety of language interfaces. So I can use Python, I can use Java, I can use SQL language, or I can use R language to write my processing logic. Now, if I compare this thing with earlier design, okay, here you will see one major difference, that stream analytics we are using. Now, stream analytics does not have language interfaces. Although if you talk about the performance, stream analytics has a little bit higher performance compared to Databricks. But what benefit do we get from the Databricks is that we can have multiple language interfaces here. Okay. Databricks comes not only with a compute, okay, it also comes with a storage. So it used to have its own storage. So if I want to mention plus points about the Databricks, very good processing speed. It has its own storage also. Okay, it can connect to variety of the data sources available on Azure. So not only Event Hub, we can connect it to other data sources also. And at the same time, we can get the high velocity data as well as low historical data, low velocity historical data. After due processing, processed data can be moved to Cosmos DB-like storage, which is queryable and which provides data near to the client, thereby benefiting the client with a low latency. IoT reference architecture. What are IoT devices? What are all IoT edge devices? What is IoT hub? Okay, so IoT devices are the electronic devices which are meant for sensing something specific, like IoT device for sensing temperature, IoT device for sensing humidity. So IoT devices for sensing different environmental parameters. These devices keep sending signals of their observations, okay, as a message to some storage device or to some compute device. Okay, these IoT devices must always be connected to some compute. They must be having 24/7, okay, connection with the compute. What if sometimes, now this compute may be on the cloud, so internet connectivity becomes mandatory for IoT devices, because IoT devices do not have storage capacity. They have to push the data to the cloud to store. On the other hand, IoT edge device has storage as well as compute capacity. So IoT edge device is IoT plus small storage and compute. IoT device is simply IoT. It doesn't have storage or compute. Okay, so sometimes we may not have connection to the cloud all the time working. Or even if we have connection to the cloud, sometimes IoT device cannot rely on cloud to take the quick decisions. Because all the way message has to travel to the cloud, it has to be processed in the cloud, and response has to come back. Okay, so in the mid of the ocean, there may not be internet connectivity. Then we have to have a local processing unit, automatically driven cars. Okay, there that car has to take a quick decision of what to do in case if there is an obstacle in front of it. The automatically driven car cannot wait for, you know, cloud to intimate to it and order to it whether to take a left turn or right turn or whether to apply the brakes. Okay, so in such cases, then we have to have IoT edge device with the working within the automatically driven car. IoT hub device provisioning service, Azure functions, logic apps, these are the different things we need in processing IoT, different kinds of services we need in processing IoT. Observe this architecture. Again, it is giving me idea about what happens with the data which comes from edge device or IoT device. From edge device, mostly I will receive a processed data or partially processed data, because edge device used to have processing capability. IoT device does not have processing capability, so we receive unprocessed data always. So somehow, whenever data comes with a very high speed, I have to maintain that data within IoT hub. So IoT hub is almost unlimited reservoir of data, which has the capacity, not only huge data storing capacity, but very high read write speed. From there, then data goes to stream processing. Here data will be processed. Now here there is one pipeline where data is processed with a high speed, and there is another pipeline, okay, where data can be processed for prediction analysis, for example. Okay, we call it as a
full screen. Please.
Okay, yes, sorry. So this is hot pipeline, this is cold pipeline. Ultimately, data goes to reporting and visualization tool. Data goes to reporting and visualization tool. Okay, so this is one end-to-end design of IoT reference architecture. Let me check here whether somebody has put any question. In case if you have any question, please put them right away. Demos are not possible in so short time. So, sorry to say, but demos cannot be covered here. What is the help of the case? Just a minute, let me read the question. Can you please explain with the help of the case study instead of presentation how it is Azure data solution designed in real life? Yes, I understand your pain. I realize that through the case study, you can understand all these things. But remember, case study will be in specific language or case study will be through different services. For that purpose, we have to ensure everybody of us are on the same page. Okay, everybody is good. Everybody has good understanding of Azure services, and everybody can learn or can understand some Python-like language also. Okay, so for that purpose, in so short span of time, very difficult to make out. What we normally do in our training, that we ask participant or we make participant to work on the different services and try to design, okay, some small case studies. Okay, so that is what we do in our training. Can you please explain with the help of the case study instead of presentation, how is the Azure data solution designed in real life? Is it possible to map data folder on user machine? Yes. For that purpose, there is one file kind of storage account is available. You can explore it further. File kind of storage account. In storage account, there are four flavors actually: blob storage, file storage, queues, and fourth one is a table. Okay, so there is a file storage which works with SMB protocol and can be mounted on the local machine as a folder. Okay, what is another question? Yes, I agree that labs would have been very much helpful, but I was not pretty sure with who all are joining. Okay, so I have to design this session to make everybody to understand. Okay, so labs would have taken longer time. Okay, so that's why I mean here it is difficult to cover labs in so short span of time. So I regret for Azure file shares. Okay. Yes. I will keep improvising such sessions. Maybe in next session I will come up with some of the labs. But otherwise in 2 days session or 3 days session of 201, there we do cover labs. Yes. Okay, so more on different reference architectures that normally we cover. Okay. We also do cover, just a minute, that processing is done.
What is the difference between DP200 and 201?
Yes, that is a good question. DP200 mainly talks about implementation. how you will create the services, how you will design the services, how you will configure the services, how you will design data pipeline using data factory, which is pulling the data from different data sources, sending the data to the Databricks, getting the processed data from the Databricks hand and pushing the data to the visualization. How you implement these things, that is all is 200 talks about. 201 talks about designing aspects and designing significances. So in 201, we do not implement much things. Here, what are all care to be taken while designing the application? What are all different alternatives available? That's all what we talk in 201. So in 201, we do add some libraries, laboratories and so on. But main focus of 201 revolves around how you will design an application. What are all different tools you will use to design specific part of the application? Actual implementation is not covered in or is not a part of 201.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's why its title is designing. 201 has a title as designing analytical analytics applications. Title of 200 is implementing analytics services. So there are the difference is visible and understandable from the titles only. So here you can see what are all different performance bottlenecks. Okay. What are all different approaches to make the services auto scalable, how, what are all different factors to increase the performance of the service. Okay, these are all discussions we hold in 201. As far as the examination is concerned, the pattern of the examination of 200 and 201 are much more similar. In 201 also there are questions are divided into three areas. In the first area, you will be given one big case study, a case study running across 6 to 7 pages. You read the case study, you pick up important points from the case study, and then it starts asking you the questions. Okay, so question number one, when is answered, and if you go to question number two, in that case, then you cannot come back to question number one. It means these questions are not navigable. So before you leave question number one, you have to ensure that you have answered it correctly. Okay, whenever you are answering the question number one, in case if you want to go back to the case study, it is possible. Okay, but if you go to the question number two, you cannot come back to question number one. So you have to say answer these questions and your answer will be full and final, because across these questions you cannot navigate. So that is the first area of the questions, or first division of the questions, I will say. Then comes a second division of the questions, okay, wherein smaller case studies will be given. And on one smaller case study, there may be 3-4 questions asked. You can navigate across these 3-4 questions. So even if you answer question one and if you go to question two, you can come back to question one. But you cannot navigate across these groups. So once you answer these 3-4 questions, and if you go to the second case study, then you cannot come back to the first case study. So in the second division of the questions, questions are MCQ. There is no hands-on for answering these questions. The questions are concept-based only. Even there are no memory-based questions. There are very few memory-based questions. Mostly questions are concept-based questions. In the division two of the questions, across the case studies, smaller case studies, you cannot do navigation. So around 15 questions for division one, around 15 questions for division two, and around 15 to 20 questions for division 3. In division 3, in case if there are 20 questions, you can navigate across all the 20 questions. So even after answering 20th question, if you want to visit and rethink on question 1, that is possible. In division 3, questions are navigable. In division 3, no case study is given, but your knowledge is simply tested. Okay, so question may be like, what kind of security is applied on the storage account, blob storage account? So there you have to answer the encryption for rest data at rest. Okay, a question may be that whenever encryption is being done, okay, where is the key? Because encryption needs a key. Okay, it can be a symmetric key or asymmetric key. Where is the key stored? And the answer can be key vault. Okay, such type of questions are asked which are not case study based. Such type of questions are asked in Division 3. So that is a major difference in between these two examinations. In Division 3, you will mostly realize that your preparation of 200 is helpful there. So I will always recommend not to directly appear for 201, but to go for 200 first, okay, and then go for 201. So your preparation of 200 will definitely help for 201. So having said that, I think I have explained you, say I have taken you to the tour of what are all topics being covered in 201. I also have explained you what type of questions are there, what is the examination pattern. Okay. Any question from your side? Go ahead, please. Yes, go ahead.
Any lab questions 200 and 201?
Lab questions, just few lab questions may be asked from 200. Just to cite an example, that they may give you, they may ask you the steps to do something specific. Like we want to pull the data from the storage push it to the SQL data warehouse. Okay, what steps you will follow if you are using Data Factory? So those steps they will ask you. And how do they ask the steps? That they will give you some steps ready. You simply have to order those steps. So they will not ask you what will be the step. They will simply ask you to order the steps. So such type of steps, which are, you know, hands-on based steps, hands-on based question they may ask you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Any other question, please? As the time is getting over, okay. So in case if you have a question, keep posting them. Otherwise, then we will conclude the session. Course content is available on the cloud, on the internet. Explain data archive for OLS data. As of now, I think I am running out of time. What is this old? So Kumar has mentioned one word, old. Achha, could you please explain data archive for old data? Okay, data archive is one of the kind of a data storage available in Azure storage. Okay, there, in case if you are choosing for archive, okay, your data is held there with a minimal cost. But for archive, what is important is, this is basically to create the backups. Basically to create the backup. Is there any webcast for AZ200? Okay. So it doesn't provide you good read-write speed. Okay. You can hold a file there which you want to hold as a backup. So data archive storages are available in Azure storage. And these are most cost-effective storages. Okay, I will check with Priyanka. Are you there? Priyanka?
Yes, sir.
Hello, Priyanka. Yes, See, there is a question about any webcast for AZ200. You have to
answer.
No, it's breaking.
Able to hear you, but your voice is breaking. It is a lot of disturbances.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, better.
So yes, we have already shared the recordings of our previous webinars on our YouTube channel. So if you want these recordings of our previous webinar, DP200 or any other webinar, just visit our YouTube channel. So any other question for CB sir?
What's the name of the YouTube channel?
Synergetics Learning and Consulting. I will also share the CB sir's LinkedIn profile in the message box. If you, any one of you having any questions, you can directly message him on his LinkedIn account. Just you need to connect with him, and after that, if you are having any questions related to any technologies, you can directly contact him.
Sorry, you're breaking.
Those who haven't registered for this webinar and want the participation certificate, mail me your details on my mail ID. I'm just texting once again my email ID in the message box. Thank you everyone for the attending this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's all.
Thank you.